I'm working.
Hey, good, good.
My name's all enough.
Good, this talks in two bits. There's the silly bit that I'm going to do, then there's the clever bit that he's going to do. We've been working in the Internet of Things for, crikey, 2.5, 3 years now. And every time we do this stuff, we find stupid, stupid things. So I'm going to do the not very technical bit, which I found really easy to do. Then I'm going to go and take us on to the next bit, which was really clever, and he did.
Yeah.
Yeah, simple as that. That's who we are. Now, before we go too much further, does everyone remember the Wi-Fi kettle? Anyone not know about the Wi-Fi kettle? Wow, that's good. You've all been listening. So, kettle, Wi-Fi enabled. Why? I have no idea. I do know why. It's actually so you can charge 100 quid for it instead of a tenner. It comes with a base which I've amazingly forgotten, which has got all the clever bit in. Stupidity. It's Wi-Fi enabled. There is no web service, so it works locally on your Wi-Fi network, nowhere else. The idea being you have a mobile app, which you press the button on when you wake up in the morning. By the time you get to the kitchen, you've got a kettle full of boiling water. Save you, what, 30 seconds of your life? 100 quid. Sounds good, doesn't it? Great. That would kind of make sense if you could, you know, dial your kettle from, you know, on the way home. You fancy a cup of tea, you know, you're on the bus or whatever. But it doesn't work like that. It only works locally. You can only do it from home in Wi-Fi range. Nuts. So, we didn't kind of get the hang of that. So, first thing we did is bought one. Actually, bought a few because I keep breaking IoT stuff. And we started taking it apart. And we started pulling it apart. First thing we do is do a bit of a port scan, have a bit of a play, get bored, get out the screwdrivers, and find this. That's the inside of the base. You can see there it is a VSD03 Wi-Fi module that is quite literally bolted onto the edge of it. That's why in the IoT, people love making money out of stuff. That's about $3 Wi-Fi module. 100 quid kettle. Wow. What amazing, amazing markups they're getting out of this stuff. So, got a Wi-Fi device, want to know how to play with it. So, first thing you're going to need to do is go and find the manual. Hang on, let me just sort this out. Go and find the manual. It's on the interwebs. There you go. Have I got something? Come on, here we go. Can I do it? Yes, fantastic. There is the manual. Tells you everything you need to know about it. But actually, the easiest way into an IoT device is through the mobile app. Because the mobile app needs to know how to talk to the Wi-Fi module. So, go and grab it, reverse it, pull it apart, and you start finding some useful stuff. So, in unconfigured mode, it acts as a wireless access point. I don't know what the IP address is. Unsurprisingly, there it is. It's in the mobile app code, so the mobile app can talk to it first time around. It's gone link local, 169.254.11. Set up to that, fantastic. Next thing you need to do is it needs to talk to the kettle. So, it runs telnet. What? Over port 23? Great. Okay, it's difficult to do SSL, haven't got an entropy source, but okay, telnet, perhaps not the best way to do it. It then needs to talk to the kettle. I could have shown you this live if I'd actually remembered to bring the base to the kettle. I can't. You telnet to it, it asks for a password. Okay. So, we go and find the password, and the password's not difficult to find, because if you go and read the manual, type in the word password, you find actually the password is, the default is 6 zeros. Right, it's in the manual. You can download it from the internet and get in. So it authenticates to it, and then it comes up with a terminal. What do we do next? Well, everything's in there. Go and have a look at the way it sets itself up. Go and have a look. So we look for 6 zeros, because that's the first thing the mobile app needs to know.
Great.
Okay, so we've got the 6 zeros. Mobile app is now talking to kettle in unconfigured state. I want to configure you. Okay, log in, 6 zeros. Next thing, AT plus WPRT. AT commands. Remember the Hayes AT modem command set? We've all used it. Yeah, this is what I love about IoT. It's like turning the clock back years and years and years. ATDT, remember dial-up modems? You've all used it. Brilliant. AT plus WPRT, go for manual scan for wireless access points. So you're telling the Wi-Fi module to look for your wireless router. You've got that? Great. Next thing I need to know, I need to be able to retrieve and set SSID of your access point so I can turn it into a wireless client. AT plus SSID. AT plus encryption. Obviously, that's the encryption type, so it's configuring itself. Next place we go is here, AT plus key. Ooh, that's interesting, it needs your Wi-Fi key, doesn't it, in order to become a client on the wireless network. Thing goes a little bit further, there's a little bit more to be done as we're configuring it. We go through and we see AT plus NIP, so it's a DHCP or not, it's not in this case. AT plus webs, it has an embedded web server, awesome. But in this case, it's turning it off with zero. Last place we go, AT plus PMTF, pass memory to flash, save. And then AT plus pass. It now takes a random 6-digit number and writes it. The problem with the Android version of this app is it never successfully calls take case 10. AT plus C, exit. So we log in, type in AT plus pass, and we retrieve your Wi-Fi key. So we can drive past houses in the street, do a deauthentication attack against the kettle, set up an evil twin, connect to it, type in six zeros, and retrieve the user's Wi-Fi key. Cool, eh? Is that crazy? Now, we did what we perceived to be the right thing. We disclosed this privately. I think that was kind of the right thing to do. And the vendor royally ignored us, frankly. I don't know about you, if you ever tried disclosing to small IoT vendors, they ignore you. They always do. So, stuff it. Ran the BBC and said, hey, we've got this vendor that's got this crazy Wi-Fi kettle that won't talk to us. Can you? And they did. And they, by and large, didn't say exactly this, but by and large, they said, look, you need specialist knowledge, so what, a Wi-Fi module? Great, okay. And a copy of Carly, perhaps? I don't know. And you'd be lucky to find a user with a kettle. Okay. Interesting, that's where we love wiggle, don't we? We love online wardrobe databases, and we had a quick look, and there's a few of them in the west of London, so that's where to go and find iKettles to go and still use the PSAs. That's a little bit old, there are loads of them out there now. Obviously these are in unconfigured state, but you can also look from the configured state as well. There's lots of other cool stuff you can do as well. You can geolocate these devices, obviously. There's a guy called Mark Cox who wrote a Python client for it, so you can go up to these kettles and turn them on when people are out for the day. That's quite good fun. So you can boil 2 or 3 litres of water and watch their plaster fall at their walls. Get in. Or steam your windows. That's good. The other thing you can do is you can keep turning them on and off continuously. And whilst it does have a bimetallic strip that trips the power if it gets too hot, it trips at 186 degrees centigrade. I know, I checked. Because if you keep doing it on over and over again, you get burn on the PCB. We haven't managed to set fire to one yet, although we tried very, very hard. Great. The same company, I think the reason why they didn't get too involved in trying to fix this bug is they released a Kettle 2.0. What? I was quite happy with Kettle 0, I don't know about you. Kettle 1.0 or whatever. And Andrew's been having quite a good look at this. We haven't successfully captured the firmware, have you?
No, I've got the firmware off it. We haven't actually got it to work, though. This is the problem. We've got the app, we've got the kettle, we haven't paired it to actually boil a kettle water. So, it's different to the old one, but it works even less well.
We haven't actually successfully got this kettle to boil in regular, unconfigured, non-hacked mode. It's that flaky, it's nuts. They have got a new one, they've got a Kettle 3.0 coming out at Christmas, I understand. So I'm looking forward to it. Apparently that one's secure. Right. This one, by the way, is completely different. It uses ESP8266, completely different wireless module. Actually, it's a really good module. You can buy various different... it has various options. The more secure versions are a bit more expensive. Guess which one they bought. Anyway, won't get that. Other crazy stuff we see all the time in mobile apps. This is the client-side code for the Kettle 2.0. This is the mobile app. And when you log into the app, it asks you for an email address and password. There's obviously no reason to do that, but they want to sell you stuff and market to you. They crazily set up a really good strong password, clearly generated by a password generator, and then put the password static in the mobile app code. So it's a really secure password unless you can get the app store.
It's important to note that's not just the password for that individual app, it's the password for SendGrid, which is an email sending service, and it looking at the documentation would allow you access to everything that's ever been sent from one of these apps.
Absolutely nuts. They give away their key customer marketing password in their mobile app code. Crazy. And the other stupid thing you can do with this kettle, if you send it a raw hex 0C, the kettle dies. Seriously, it costs about 300 quid in dead kettles proving this actually works. what? And we had a bit of fun, so we went out and looked on Wiggle for unconfigured kettles, and correlated that with the amount of time they've been seen for. So you can actually find a bunch of these kettles, so by the SSID you know they're unconfigured, and correlated to look how long they've been on Wiggle for in this unconfigured state. So you can pretty much guarantee that those are never going to be configured. You've got their latitude and longitude, so you can go and find kettles to kill. And there's one, right opposite NCC's office in Manchester. Who knows? It does get worse though. Another great example I've got up here. This is an espresso prodigio. It's an espresso machine. It's Bluetooth enabled. There's a mobile app you can use that you can turn it on remotely to make coffee. The bit that you can't do remotely is put a capsule in. So in order to tell it remotely to make coffee, you've got to have gone up to it, put a cup underneath it, put a capsule in and closed it, and then you can go away and turn it on. And I think that's crazy. Really, really crazy. But the other stupid things we see in mobile apps for IoT devices all the time, really, really serious permission creep. That, the mobile app that runs this thing, has got the permission to make silent phone calls without your permission. It's a coffee machine. Wow, what is going on there? And we pulled apart the mobile app for a bit of fun. And in there, we found this crazy stuff. Hopefully I've got it here. Have I done it? Yeah, this is the, it also has e-commerce functionality. So the mobile app allows you to keep tabs on how many capsules you use and automatically reorder. And it's got a low capsule threshold. So when you get to a certain number, you can automatically order more. They have validated that input, but they've validated that low threshold to a maximum of 65,000. Wow, you can have so much fun modifying that. So as soon as your capsule threshold gets below 65,000, you can order more. Okay, cool, we can do some serious dossier, can't we? A lot of fun to be had with that, but other crazy stuff. Now, gonna move on. Gonna talk about my doll. Has anyone seen my friend Caleb, the talking doll? Really? You haven't seen her? I'm shocked, she's brilliant. She is. Internet-enabled IoT doll. She's got a microphone and a speaker on her and Bluetooth. The idea being is that she does speech-to-text, does that on a mobile app, and then uses a third-party, I think it's new ones, to do speech-to-text, and then starts to look at what the child said to it, and then tries to respond. She has no pairing pin over Bluetooth. Now, given she's Bluetooth-enabled, got a microphone and a speaker, you can actually connect her up to your mobile phone and use her as a headset. Seriously, we've done phone calls on this bitch. That's crazy. And I'm sure you know, I did this talk to some police investigators a little while back, and obviously it's illegal to use your phone to your ear when you're driving over here. And I asked them, well, what if I was talking to my doll? I said, yeah, I think we'll arrest you. I'm not quite sure what we charge you with. But anyway, the box she comes in, so I saw her in Toys R Us, and says, look, this is child safe. It filters out swear words. Yeah, really? Oh, what an opportunity. Could we bypass this anti-swearing filter? So here's an explanation of how she works. You're going to have to bear with me. This diagram is nuts. So the first thing you can do, because she's got no pairing pin, she'll pair to any Bluetooth device in range. Encryption, she'll pair to anything. Obviously, if she's connected to a device concurrently, she won't talk to you. All you have to do is give her another audio source, and you can speak through the doll. So you can be outside on the road, and you can be connected to the doll and talking to a child through their toy. That's quite horrible. I don't like that at all. But that was too easy, so we thought we'd have a bit of fun. And the way she works, so she's got the voice processing over here on the mobile app, SQLite database locally that's got a bunch of stuff in. And what we started doing was taking apart the database, and this is how she operates. So she's got about 3,000 questions that she can answer quickly. So if you ask her a question she recognises, she'll look in as each child here, try and identify the text, and then respond. She does this very quickly. A great example, you can see where some retailers have clearly been involved in her production. Have you been to a Target store before? Okay. Yeah, I like to shop at Target because of all the cool clothes they have. My mum lets me push the red car. Really? Wow. Okay. The problem is while she has a swearing filter, by the way, the swearing filter's over here. I hope you're not offended. There you go. That's what she's not allowed to say. Brilliant. That's quite cool. There's lots of different things you can do here. First of all, the anti-swearing filter only operates the stuff the child says to the doll. So you can just change the content of the question database, to say anything you want. And there's a few bits and pieces that she does. I won't leave that up too long. Anyway, the other thing you can do is, of course, you can simply remove the swearing words from the database. So you can just delete that database and everything is fine. Don't you just love it? Right. Now, let's see if this is going to work. I have pre-recorded this. Really, why do you have to screen my comment? Let's give it a go. Hopefully she will work.
Hello.
Hey, calm down, or I will kick the shit out of you.
Oh dear. Anyway, there are lots of things you can do with that. Right, so apart from that first one, you can also add swear words. You can also mess around with the API. So she does a lookup. If it's a question she doesn't know locally, she'll look it up on the Wikipedia API. She does that unencrypted, or she did do that unencrypted, so you can just jump in, man the middle, and send grot back to her. Or you can just remove the swear words from the database. Brilliant. We disclosed this. The vendor said, yeah, we're going to fix the app. And they, instead of doing what we recommended, which was implement SSL on the API call, and do some other stuff, they implemented SQL Cipher on the database, which did stop our attack, until we realized that they'd implemented SQL Cipher with a static encryption key in the client-side code. So we've got the key, we've just encrypted it. What? And it wasn't even as there were unique keys per device. They didn't re-key when they first installed, so they had the same static encryption key for every single instance of this damn app. They totally misunderstood. And then the doll stopped working. Wikipedia wisely went, we probably ought to enforce SSL. So they actually locked the doll out of Wikipedia by enforcing SSL-only calls to the API. Nuts. Another research, this is quite funny. Another researcher had a look at the iOS version. We were looking at Android. And while reversing the iOS version, they found as an extra special sound. They found a machine gun noise in code. I don't know. Maybe that's a special action coder. And this guy is still shipping today. His mouth moves, got exactly the same vulnerable app. You could do exactly the same to him. The Bluetooth is still completely unprotected. That's crazy. And then this little guy. Who has got one of these? They're absolutely brilliant. Anyone got an E8? It's a great excuse to buy a toy for security research. This little guy, I love him. We got him at Christmas for research, not me at all. And a great example. So you can push out new firmware updates to him using the mobile application. And if you go into the mobile app, which is over here, reversed it quickly, what do you find? In the firmware update class, it's doing a plain text, HTTP. Okay. Quite difficult to exploit. I absolutely get this. You know, you've got to intercept the man in the middle, someone doing a triggering a firmware update from the mobile application. But you could push new firmware to BBA and potentially turn it to the dark side. Hey, awesome, fun and games. So, where did we get to? I'm trying to remember what I was talking about. Right now, this is where I really want to move on to where IT starts to get a bit dangerous. There was a really interesting story last week. Everyone see the Brian Krebs DDoS story?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I have to say, I looked at that story, I thought, that's nothing. 660 gigabits per second. What I've seen already out there in terms of IoT potential to do DDoS, that's nothing. And this is where Andrew comes in.
Yeah, so this was quite a long time ago, back at the start of this year. I was a bit bored. I went on Amazon and I thought I'd order the cheapest DVR I could find. This was probably about 30 quid, no hard drive in it. But it had very good reviews, a lot of people using it, probably about 70 reviews when I ordered it. But what it turns out is the security of this device cannot be any worse. It really is as bad as it gets. The first thing I noticed was, when I got it, very distinctive HTTP headers. It had a server string that was completely unique to it. We could find 44,000 of these open or shown up. So that means 44,000 people have port forwarded to this device, so you can access the web interface. So they're quite vulnerable already. So you can see most of them are in Turkey, India, kind of distributed towards the Middle East, but they're spread all over the world. Nice geographic distribution. But what we found was this thing was just full of security holes. The best one was that the way it authenticated is you check your password when logged in, it posted it to a web form, as you'd expect. But after that, it set a cookie, two cookies, DVR password and DVR user. It turned out, as long as those cookies were set to any value, you could log into the device. So it didn't have to be your password, it didn't have to be your username. To top it off, it was your username and password if you had typed it in, so it was leaked through the cookies as well. These are on the internet, so we could already log into the device. That's quite bad. But logging into it, all you could do is use it like a normal user. But it gets a lot worse. We popped it open, connected up a serial cable to it to get access to the shell on it, which was of course open. Got the main binary off it, it's a custom web server, and we found this reference to shell with a query answer. We thought, this is quite interesting. So rather than do any hard work on this, I put PS after it, and there we go. We've got all the processes running on the DVR there. You might notice that the user and the only user there is root. I don't think we've ever seen a cheap IoT device that doesn't run all as root. So we thought, yeah, could it get any worse than this? And yeah, the answer is yes, it could get worse than this. So,
switch back on.
So it got a lot worse than this. The version of the firmware I had was periodically sending stills from the first channel of the DVR through to an address, Laura's here at yeah.net, with who are you, attaching a snapshot and sending it to this guy. Now, it wasn't in all of the firmwares. He claimed it was a development firmware. I'm kind of willing to believe it was a bit of a mistake that was left in there. Just as a joke, I thought I'd send Button Moon intro frame by frame to him. It was probably about 3 gigs worth of traffic sent in the end. But yeah, I mean, this is the kind of invasion of privacy you can get from a DVR. So the DVR is quite interesting. It was popular on the internet, a few people looked at it, but we were kind of struggling to get the public to be interested in IoT security. So we thought, well, a lot of people know about ransomware. Everyone knows about ransomware. I'm sure some of you have been hit by ransomware. So we thought, can we get ransomware onto an IoT device? So I'm just going to move over to my laptop for the technical presentation. We did this at DefCon. It's going to be a slightly different presentation to that. It's going to focus maybe more on the defense. Hopefully this will work.
Yeah,
there we go. So, yeah, we did this talk at DefCon. Make sure that's pulled off. What we decided to do is to put ransomware on the thermostat. Now, it was a bit of an unfair game. We wanted to pick a target and succeed. We weren't taking any thermostat and trying to root it. We were picking our target, so it was a little bit unfair. There's no elite attacks in this. It is very, very basic. IoT is simple. Hacking is simple. So mistakes you were making 20 years ago are being made on IoT. I'm going to go through how we found the holes in it and what we do to fix them. Just to get an idea, how many of you here are developers or builders? How many of you are pen testers? Any security architects or... Yeah, so we've got a bit of a blend here. So there's quite a few people on the building rather than attacking side. So we have to look at why IoT is different. Many IoT devices, they only allow you to interact through the app nowadays. But what manufacturers are doing is they're still leaving all of the functionality from the legacy devices, web interfaces, APIs, telnet, and everything running on these devices. That lets us exploit them locally. But the problem is you've got no control over these. If you go and buy a Wi-Fi kettle, you have no guarantee you're going to get a firmware update for that. It's kind of like the situation with some Android phones. You're not quite sure if you're going to get an update for it. We know they're not going to update these, to be honest. It's pretty much a given.
I think we actually tried it and it bricked itself, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. But we've also got this problem that now, if they decide to pull the power functionality, you lose access to your device as well. Which, you know, this is a big difference compared to how devices were years ago. You don't really own your devices. What's important is the attacker profile's changed. So when we're looking at web servers, we're always looking at the external hacker, really. But now, that's completely different. The device might not be the final goal. These are brilliant pivots onto your local network. This thing here, it's a powerful Linux box. The thermostat over there, it's a powerful Linux box. The DVR, it's a powerful Linux box. And they're on your network. They're behind your firewall, and you're allowing people to access and control them. It can do anything that a normal computer can do, but you cannot tell it's doing it. It's a real risk. There's other attackers, though. The device might be the gateway onto the infrastructure. Say there's a messaging service running on the device. This is quite common on thermostats. They message using XMPP or something to a central server. There's no authentication. Once you've routed the device, you're onto the infrastructure so you can take control of other devices. This is what's really important, the physical access mantra. You've probably heard people say this before, that once someone has physical access to your machine, it's game over. It's not true with IoT devices. They are giving you the device. They're giving the attacker the device to look at. They have to protect these well enough that you cannot get onto them without expending significant effort, and they aren't doing that. Our first target, largely because they're available in the UK, was this thermostat. How many of you have got internet-enabled thermostats? How many of you are lying? It's an ARM-based system. It's got a colour screen. It's got JTAG. And what it turned out, we could pull the flash memory, the program memory, over JTAG and examine it and reprogram it. But it wasn't running Linux. It kind of made this quite a challenging target. We weren't going to get a shell on it, so we decided that maybe this wasn't a great idea. You can see the PCB here. It's got a massive ARM Cortex microcontroller, external flash that stored the images on it, and a Wi-Fi module. Again, the way these are linked through to these microcontrollers, they're not fast, you're not going to really be able to do that much of them. What's going on here? So we connected to JTAG on it, we downloaded the flash, and we found a hidden debug menu on it. You could read it. Number one, testing backlight. Number two, testing RTC. Right down at the bottom it said 10, connect USB cable. It's got a USB port in it. Why has it got the USB port? So what we did was we found that if you jumped to the program memory where this debug menu was, plugged in USB at exactly the same time, it showed up as a mass storage device with a load of images. You could change the images. So just as a joke, we changed it to a ransomware image. The thing was that the device wasn't actually running a ransomware. It was just a bit of a joke. So what we thought was we'd go for something a bit better. So, like I said, we're picking our target. We can choose. So we found this thermostat. It's from the US. It wouldn't really work in the UK. That's it there, powered up. It's ARM-based. We checked the FCC docs. I don't know how many of you know about this. In terms of hardware hacking, if you're selling any wireless device in the US, you have to go through what's called FCC certification. And what that means is you have to have it tested. But in turn, it means you have to submit photos of the boards to the FCC. You also have to submit things like the schematics and the operation of it. Most people keep the schematics private. They send a letter saying, no, they're not allowed to publish them. But the internal photos, except for really, really high security stuff, are always published. So even without buying a device, we could see what was inside it. So we looked at this and we thought, this is a good target. Ordering from the US is going to take a lot of time, but we thought it would be good, so we went for it. Just taking a look at it in a bit more depth. It's got a powerful ARM processor, so it's a standalone processor. You've got external flash and RAM, so it's got 128 megabytes of RAM. That doesn't sound like much, but in terms of IoT gear, it's actually really quite big. 1 gigabit of NAND flash, which is actually quite small. It's also got this tiny little chip here, which is no bigger than the size of my little finger thumbnail, is the Wi-Fi module. Everything's on there. Compared to a USB stick, that's absolutely tiny. It's quite impressive. But it's also got an SD card slot on it, which is underneath where I've soldered these pinheads. So that's quite interesting. There was no JTAG on it, though. JTAG's a way of us connecting to the device and querying it in a way that allows us to pull the firmware, control it, and so on. So we had this module, we got one of them to arrive, and we started taking a look at it. In terms of software, it's a Linux-based device. It's running BusyBox. I don't know how many of you have heard about BusyBox. It's a minimal system that implements things like Telnet, FTP, SSH, and so on, all in one big binary. It's very, very common on embedded devices. It's actually quite secure. There's not been that many vulnerabilities found in the last few years. They keep things simple. It was using an ASH shell, which is annoying because it makes scripting much harder. But it didn't have any ports open on it. So that thing, when you port scanned it, nothing was open. All it was doing was communicating from there through to the internet. Your phone's communicating through to the internet, and all the commands are being passed around like that. So we don't have anything running on it to exploit. Now, that makes things difficult, really. We can't touch the cloud service because the computer misuses that. We have to always just observe on that side. But what was interesting is, now, I never could foresee myself doing this, is that you can configure this, you can customize this. So there's this PC-based application, and it uses Adobe Air. Now, if any of you got Adobe Air installed on your desktop computer, I'd advise not having it installed. It's generally been a bit of a security risk in the past. But what this software does is you can change the settings on the thermostat, you can change the background images, set schedules, and so on. So it allows you to customize it. And the way it does that is via an SD card slot. So it's got an SD card slot. You write up the PC, put it in there, and you can reprogram it. It also included the firmware. which was helpful. So what we did was we took the firmware from it, and we unpacked it. So we extracted it from the SD card. It's just a bin file. Now, the way these file systems work is they're a big binary blob. And there's this amazing tool that's been about for a few years now called Binwalk, written by a guy called Craig Heffner. And what it does is it looks at this binary file, and it looks for signatures. So it looks for things like, it looks for strings, it looks for gzip headers for different file systems, and then it tries to unpack the file system. Now, I'll be honest, it doesn't work most of the time. It gives you a good hint as to what you need to do, but it doesn't really tell you or extract automatically. We hit lucky with this thing, though. It just worked. So what we've got now is a file system. So you can see there, you've got etc, you've got media, mount, proc, and so on. It's a normal Linux file system, and we've got access to that. They haven't protected that very well at all. So what we thought we'd do at this stage is look at how the firmware works. Now, pretty much all of it had a single monolithic binary running this read. I mean, it was probably about 2 or 3 megs in size, which is quite a big binary for an embedded system. It did everything. It did the user interface, so it actually does the display on the front of it, does cloud connectivity, the web server which you can turn on it, firmware upgrades, and it also connects to the Wi-Fi. Everything's done through this massive binary. But what actually drives it is this MXE file, which is JavaScript, and it's 750 kilobytes. Now, I don't know how many of you work with JavaScript. There's some desktop stuff that goes up to 750k, but you know, this is big for JavaScript. It looked like this though, really, really hard to read. But we can see that it was calling, it was executing commands, querying a SQLite database, and so on. So it looked quite interesting. We ran it through JSBeautify, which is just an application that kind of makes everything tidy again. So we've got this lovely output here. It had a lot of these exec commands, so it was running commands and it was running this root. Now that, to me, shouts command injection. There wasn't much evidence of user input validation. Now and then it was checking for a string instead of a number and so on. But you could see things like it was doing copy, gallery path, plus image array and so on. So it was executing commands. We thought, okay, it looks like there could be command injection here. But finding that would be quite difficult. We don't really have full access onto the device at this stage. We can't see what's going on, just use the display. What's interesting though is vendors assume the firmware's hidden. People, I'm sure you've all done this, anyone who develops it, you've put comments in code that you hope the customer will never ever see, or even some of your colleagues. But you look in this firmware here, right down the bottom of the SSL handling, we've got unhandled SSL shit status, which is its way of saying things have gone wrong with SSL. But better still, it's got screensavers. And it can do, you know, transitions, so you can do blinds and checkerboards, things like that. But it's also got this hidden mode called son of a bitch. Now, it doesn't seem to do anything different to the other things, but it's still in there. The developers did not intend for us to see this. So we wanted to get rid of this. We wanted to get a way of executing commands. So we assumed there was command injection. So what I did was I went through every single field I could find, and I put ping, continuous, and then I incremented through different IPs. So I started at 1, then 2, then 3, and so on. Put in every single field that I thought could accept command injection, and then started playing with the thermostat to see if I could trigger it. Eventually, I got pings to 12, 12, 12 coming out of the device through to the network. So we know that images, path, and this ping command here is actually being executed. That's all right, but it's still not really got us access to the thermostat. So what we do is, there's a tool called Netcat. It's kind of like a universal network tool that allows you to build reverse shells, normal shells, listening servers, port forward, things like that. It's very, very, very versatile. We wanted to cross-compile that, so build it on a Windows, a Linux PC, an x86 PC for this ARM board, and then we copied it across onto it. So we changed the command, wget, and then we go to, I should have probably got rid of that, that's my server, downloads a shell script, makes it executable, and executes it. That shell script then downloads netcat, sets up a reverse shell listening on port 24, we tell them to port 24, and we have root on this device. That's great, again. It lets us see how the device is going, but it still sounds quite infeasible. We had a few problems with it as well. The Wi-Fi module kind of breaks when you download anything of any significant size, so we had to split things up. It took quite a while, about 2 nights, so not that long. what we wanted to do is we wanted to convert this into a much better shell. So this time, we cross-compile BusyBox. We add Telnet into it, because it's missing Telnet. And then we modify the device so that all the init scripts start Telnet when it starts up. And now we have a permanent shell onto the device. Again, this is quite good. It allows us root access, but we can do better than that. So we thought, let's get the ransomware going on this device. So how are we going to do that? We could modify that JavaScript file, but it's 750k, and every time you change it, if you make a mistake, any syntax error, which in JavaScript is quite easy to do, it will not boot. It will keep on going into a loop, you lose network access, and then you have to fix it by doing an emergency firmware upgrade, which is a bit of a pain. So we thought we'd just modify existing functionality. So what we did was we took the screen sample and we set it to the ransomware picture. We locked it using the existing PIN, but we kept on changing the PIN every minute. So there was no way that someone would be able to brute force it. It's only 4 digits. It's got a buzzer in it. Now this is great. When I was testing this, I found out that it's got a piezo buzzer in it. And piezo buzzers don't just stop at kind of normal hearing range. They go up to like 18 or 20 kilohertz. And when you make this thing make a 20 kilohertz noise come out of it, cats go absolutely mental. So I've had 2 new kittens in the house for 3 days, and my partner's telling me to stop winding up the cats with the thermostat. It's not the kind of thing you normally hear. You can change the outputs to whatever you want to. You can turn the heating on and off, the aircon on and off. You can even cool and heat at the same time. But what I also got was an IRC-based botnet. Now this was horrifically awful. It was C code that I wrote myself. It just connected back to a server and allowed you to execute commands on it and turn the ransomware off. And just to show you how it works, I'm going to probably struggle to do this with the microphone. This SD card here that's got commands on it, you just pop it inside there. You press menu. Go to settings. SD card. Import from SD card. Choose images, and then it says, do you want to override the data? Give it a second or two. So now you've got this making annoying noises. You know, we're executing commands through an SD card interface. It might not sound that impressive, having to do a local attack on one of these devices, but then you look at Mr. Robot, and they actually pulled a thermostat off the wall, and then put a Raspberry Pi behind it to attack a building management system. That will stop anyone now having.
It didn't yesterday.
Maybe I should unplug it. We've got full control of the outputs of it as well, so we can do whatever we want. But what's the attack vector on this? How are we actually going to get a user to do this? And you kind of have to think outside of the box. The Air app is 120 megabytes. Now it's big. It needs Air installed, which is another sort of 30 or 40 megabytes. If you wrote a 500k.net app that did the same as that Air app and started publishing it on forums for home automation, people would download it. If every 1 in 10 of those then went and put this malware onto the devices, people wouldn't notice. You don't have to have it make these noises straight away. It's just crashed, which is why it stopped making noise. The other interesting thing about it is that it comes in a commercial version as well. So this is our ransomware screenshot.
It was kind of cocked up when we got the Bitcoin exchange rate wrong. So it's a $200 thermostat. We're asking people for 600 quid. Oops.
Yeah, that wasn't quite. We should have checked that. But yeah, it's got a commercial device that's got more functionality in it, and you can enable that using the SD card. So again, we could have an app, publish it on forums that says make your thermostat a commercial thermostat for free. People are going to use it, and it can tamper with the device and install ransomware. The other thing is, it's just so easy to tamper with the firmware and resell on eBay, and most IoT gear has this problem. There's no signing or encryption of firmware, which means you can just tamper with it. So I guess you want to know how you fix this, just as well as how you break it. You should encrypt your firmware and sign your firmware. That stops it being unpacked and inspected. Now some people call this security through obscurity. Security through obscurity is when your only or primary defense is obscurity. This is just a layer in defense in depth. If you can stop people looking at your firmware, you can stop them finding embarrassing bugs. It's just the harsh reality that you are going to make mistakes. Signing the firmware would mean that no one else can make a firmware look at bottom. That wasn't a particular attack vector here. It was a writable partition we looked at. And this one's really important, because so much that we find. Never, ever trust any user input. And it doesn't matter where it comes from. If it comes from an SD card, the keyboard, and this is an interesting one that my colleagues are looking at, SSIDs. If you set up a wireless network with XSS in the name of the SSID on a number of different devices, was this one of them, or was it just, yeah, this was one of them. If you get this, you can get it to download JavaScript from the SSID and then execute it, and then send the PSK to a remote server on this device. That's not pretty good, really, is it? Again, we've never seen anything really that doesn't run everything as root. If we had some of these things not running as root, what we'd be able to do is we'd have to take, we'd have to go through privilege escalation, go from the web server to having root. That makes our job so much more difficult. Kind of going through the rest of these things, this is an interesting difference in between these two thermostats. This one's a traditional UK thermostat. It's got what's called a relay in it. It's a hardware switch controlled by a magnet. And it's either on or off. It flips from one side to the other. So this can cool as well as heat, but it can never do both at the same time. This one, however, it's got three different outputs for three different zones, but they're controlled by what we call triacs, which are kind of like transistors for higher voltages in AC, I guess. But you can turn on heating and cooling at the same time. You can do it for all three of the outputs on it, and you can do it as fast as you want. The relay is limited to about 10 times per second. You can do it 100 times per second on this. Now, most boilers really, really don't like being turned on and off 100 times a second, so you can actually start causing physical damage. It's getting a bit scary. But the thing here is third-party testing. Two evenings found these vulnerabilities, and they could have been fixed. It's not even a pen test. What we are doing here is finding one vulnerability and finding our way in. A pen test looks for all vulnerabilities, or as many as we can find. Fundamentally, though, it's only a thermostat. You think it's safe behind a firewall. So maybe 5 years ago, if you wanted to access IP cameras in your house, what you did was you port forwarded. So you took a port on your router and you forwarded through to your to your device behind the firewall, which it opened it up to exposure on the internet. So they got rid of that. But most IoT gear's got a web interface or an API, and they don't have any cross-site request forgery protection. I don't know if everyone's really familiar with cross-site request forgery. What it means is a third-party site, so eor.io, my web server, can make requests onto another site. It's constrained by what's called the same origin policy. It won't actually get the result of making unless it's allowed to. It won't get the result, but it's allowed to make the request. If there's no way of preventing against this, you can just send the command through to another device saying change password, or send stills to an FTP server under my control. And we reckon probably half of IoT gear's got this problem. People don't segregate their networks. So you're just sat on your normal computer. You can browse to a normal website with your little device safe behind your firewall with no port blocking. Go to a website, and it can connect to your device using CSRF. Now this is starting to sound a bit scary. But what we can also do is we can spray this CSRF across the whole network. Now, we've all got home networks. I bet most people are running 192.168.0 or 192.168.1 as their IP address. We just go through all 256 IP addresses. We don't care. We'll just send the CSRF across all of them. Now, my colleague's been looking into this, and he's found so many things. We've had routers where you can change the password. We've got this where you can send the PSK, cameras where you can send the images to other people, and it's just not being protected against. The worst thing is a lot of these devices, the web interface is no longer used. It's all cloud connected, it's all cloud configured. So it's completely pointless that this is there. This is just a quick example of how it works. It wouldn't look nice on a user's browser because you might see the games up, but this is an 8x8 grid. Or possibly more than that. And it's just going through making all of the different requests. So you can see it's found two devices, and it's carried out a CSRF request. Then this is a capture from Apache running on a third-party server, and we've got the SSID from that. So this is really quite bad. You're not safe behind a firewall. You need to protect against CSRF. We're actually seeing this in the wild to control home routers. There's essentially a pack out there you can pay for. It will take control of probably about 15 really common routers, and then it can be used in DDoS attacks or whatever you want. It's quite scary. But what's the actual impact here? So Ken's already talked about the DDoS side of things. You can use these to send data, lots of data. Imagine if you can get 200,000 IoT devices to send data to everywhere. But you need to stop thinking of these as isolated devices. A lot of people say, well, it's a thermostat, what's the worst you're going to do? You're going to turn someone's heating on. Well, if you think of it like that, yeah. As I mentioned earlier, they're powerful Linux boxes behind your firewalls, a real risk there. But you can't tell when they've been owned. How do you know that there's malware on your thermostat, or your router, or anything like that? You're not going to know. There's no way for you to detect it. And this is scary. They're going to be used for data exfiltration, owning other boxes and persisting on the network. I can guarantee that someone who's had a malware infection on their network is going to clean their Windows PCs. They're not going to go through the building management system and take every thermostat and make sure that's not got Linux on it. But what happened if we turned off 200 thermostats at the same time while controlling air conditioning? We'd have a massive load on the grid. Now, this isn't, it's perhaps a little bit ridiculous, but it would be possible to turn on that many devices, load the grid so high that you get a blackout, and you'd end up in what's called a black start condition where nothing has any power. It's very, very difficult to restart from those conditions. And we're kind of getting to that stage where there's enough devices out there as to be possible. And this came up the other day. How many of you got smart meters in your houses? Just the guy who thinks IoT is horrific. So smart meters have been rolled out across the UK. And the common ones are Landis and Gerr E470. It's the only one I've ever seen, in fact. I didn't realise this. I looked at a developed one, which was different. But the ones that are being deployed have a remote disconnect. They can disconnect your electricity remotely. It's designed to be used when you haven't paid your bill. But what would happen if someone got control of all of these devices and turned off 100,000 or an entire customer base of a given provider? It's starting to get quite scary what IoT can do.
Yeah, I think there's an interesting point there. So the vulnerability we showed there is local code execution. Okay, yeah, you've got to be there, you know, or you've got to do something cool to get the user to install. That was DefCon's demo. Since then, we found a popular thermostat brand with remote code execution, and you can identify them on Showdown. Obviously, we're not disclosing that. It's with the vendor right now resolving it. But we've identified over 250,000 of these things on Showdown already. Remote code execution, you can now take control to turn things on and off concurrently. And that talk about the black start is a really, really serious issue. You can take down the grids by taking control of these devices. It's not just DDoS anymore. You're causing issues with the critical national infrastructure. Might sound a bit far-fetched. I really, really hope it is. But we think it's possible already.
I don't know how we're doing for time. 5 minutes. There's just more and more of these devices. This is a Samsung smart fridge. Again, we can't quite work out why you want the smart fridge. It's essentially got an Android tablet in the front of it. When we looked at it, it was totally overboard, to be honest. So it's just completely pointless. We spent a long time testing. This was at DefCon 2015, wasn't it? But it didn't encrypt your Gmail password. So it was sending your Gmail password to get the calendar in the clear. Over your Wi-Fi.
Didn't pin the certs, as I remember.
It didn't pin the certs, so you could intercept it. Again, it's a pretty small problem, but it's just indicative of how bad IoT is.
Oh, do you want to do it? I don't think we've got time to do the car.
No.
Cool. I think, just a very quick one on the car. You probably saw the Mitsubishi Outlander hack. We've discovered through the mobile application that interfaces with the car over Wi-Fi, and you can switch the alarm off remotely. You crack the PSK, it's only 10 characters, and you can disable someone's car alarm. How cool is that? Once you disable the car alarm, jangle the door, hit the door lock, program a new key from the onboard diagnostics board. That's bonkers. Unbelievable. The Wi-Fi key was only 10 characters long. That's crazy. It took 2.5 days to crack that. I actually got a little video of it happening. Do you want to just play that? So this is
maybe understanding how the protocol works. I'm realizing to successfully turn the lights on.
There you go. So turn the lights off. But they turn themselves off after 15 seconds. That's a bit
boring. You do realize you could have been sat in the car, didn't you? Yeah, the app had a lot of information in it again. It was reverse engineering the app, how we worked out how it was interfacing with the car.
Straightforward binary protocol, just sat there, man in the middle, wire sharp to figure out what it was doing, and found the codes to disable the theft alarm.
Cool.
Don't show me talking again. There you go. We wrote a Python script for it as well. Great example of horrific disclosure as well. You can track it with Wiggle.
Yeah, they were all over Wiggle. So this was pre-disclosure, but you can see there's an awful lot of them. These are unique instances of them as well. We disclosed it. It went on the BBC News, and our recommendation is to turn the Wi-Fi off, which is quite simple to do, and it reduced to this many. Still 400 of them, they haven't really reduced, so we assume these are the people who want to keep the Wi-Fi on.
Nuts. Why would you drive around a car knowing that the alarm can be disabled over Wi-Fi? Crazy. It's got a horrific firmware update functionality. The disclosure was quite funny, actually. I rang them and said, okay, send us details. All right, so we did. They didn't call us back. I rang them again. They said they didn't think it was a problem. Okay, I own one of these cars. I do think it's a problem. So we told the BBC, said, Mitsubishi don't think it's a problem. BBC spokesman, Mitsubishi think it's a problem now. Good on them. Hey, cool. Great example, this is where the disclosure goes wrong. What we should have, send us the details, we'll validate it, and we'll then have a discussion about how long it's going to take to fix, and we disclose once it's fixed. But they didn't do it by that, so we never stuffed, which is ridiculous. Anyway, I think it's probably time to wrap it up there. But we found it interesting. Thanks very much, guys. Have we got any questions?
Yeah, thank you very much. As we see already, regulations, especially for the vendors of such small devices. And as you said, maybe the hacking of 1994 is still valid now with IoT. So, is there any efforts in putting regulations for these vendors?
So, the question is there any regulations? So, regulation clearly be the solution to this. The answer is no. Scary, isn't it? There's a lot of organizations working on some. So, the US Food and Drug Agency is looking at, they're looking at medical devices. They've published some guidance already. Over here, we've got the IoT Security Foundation is about to publish some basic guidance and a self-assessment framework, which is a start at least. I believe that some of the accreditation bodies like BSI and TUV, they're looking at it as well. But yeah, we've got a real problem. Like, there is no regulation to cover IoT that I'm aware of.
Okay, if there are no more questions, thanks very much, Ken and Andrew. So we've got a quick break, 5 minutes break before the next presentation starts. If you just tell us outside there. If there's any pizza or beer, if you have it, then we'll chat. 5 minutes start.